This is the way we were. Some 15,000 of us in the heat of a Georgia sun. Young, strong, trained to handle the weapons of war. Wearing our neatly pressed dress uniforms, the color was olive drab, but the brass was shining. Stripes on sleeves, or bars, or leaves, or wings, or stars on the shoulders. Which of us will be heroes? Which of us will die in combat? Which of us will grow old with our memories? Memories of colorful battle patches we wore on our shoulders. Forged of bravery and steel, one said. Another said, make way. And another, wisdom, courage, strength. Now, the ranks of our brave comrades who wore these are thinning and disappearing. But we have left here a visual record, a legacy, a witness of our deeds for generations to come. Please browse, appreciate, revere these, our pictorial remembrances.
During the Battle of the Bulge, the Third Army moved farther and faster and engaged more divisions in less time than any other army in the history of the United States, possibly in the history of the world, made possible only by the superlative quality of American officers, American men, and American equipment. General George Patton, United States Army.
Who were those American men and officers? If you saw the movie Patton, you know the most important officer was General Patton. If you saw the Band of Brothers, you know the American soldiers were the 101st Airborne Division. But the Germans were confounded by other fighting men, other men they called the Ghost Division. Who were those stubborn, brave, unyielding warriors? Why were they unknown, unheralded heroes who fought in the frozen hell of the fields around Bastogne? How had they arrived so quickly and so mysteriously where nothing had been before? Why did they move behind a veil of absolute secrecy? And isn't it about time for the lifting of the veil? Hello, I'm Ray Moore. The answer to most of our questions is the officers and men of the 10th Armored Division, U.S. Army. General Nathan Bedford Forrest of the Civil War used to say, the key to winning battles is to get thar fustest with the mostest. In the battle for Bastogne, the 10th Armored Division got there first, but with the least. Almost always outnumbered. Almost always overwhelmed by awesome forces. Yet resisting even unto death. In early December, General Patton had warned that the Allies were spread too thin along the Luxembourg and Belgian border. Hitler saw the same weakness and dispatched a quarter of a million men across a 75-mile front in a desperate drive to reach the Channel port of Antwerp. Patton had planned for the 10th to drive steel-tipped spearheads across the Saar River in his march to the Rhine. Hitler derailed those plans.
On December the 16th, 1944, about 6 p.m., I received a telephone call from General Walker, the 20th Corps, informing me that I was going to be transferred with the entire division to the 1st Army and be placed under the 8th Corps, that there had been an attack by the Germans in the vicinity of Luxembourg.
In a brilliant maneuver resembling their cavalry predecessors, the Tigers wheeled away from a planned eastward attack on the Siegfried Line and made a 90-degree turn to the north. Brigadier General Pyburn's Combat Command A rolled tanks and guns 75 miles in 18 hours and, without stopping, slammed into the German south flank to blunt the onslaught a scarce 20 miles from Luxembourg City. The astonished Nazis had expected only weak resistance. They were baffled by the appearance and tenacity of what they could only call the Ghost Division. The enemy could not identify it because the generals had ordered all division insignia covered up and for radios to remain silent. They did not want the Germans to know we had abandoned our drive into the Czar River Basin. Had they discovered that sector was now vacant, the Nazis could either have attacked the weak spot or released even more troops for the Battle of the Bulge. So for the remainder of the struggle, neither the Germans nor the war correspondents were aware of this armored division, the 10th Armored, the first unit called upon to stem the raging drive. Our leading Sherman tanks ground over the cobblestone streets of Bastogne on December the 18th, 8 hours before the 101st Airborne Division arrived.
I preceded my outfit into Bastogne and got into Bastogne about 4 o'clock in the afternoon and found General Middleton. General Middleton asked me how my outfit fought and how many pieces my outfit would fight in. I told him 3. He said, all right, send one to Noville, which is 6 or 7 kilometers north, one east to Longvilly, and one southeast to Bra.
Capture of Bastogne, hub from which 7 main roads spread like spokes in all directions, was essential to the swift movement of Field Marshal Geert von Rundstedt's troops. Riding the crest of a 14-mile advance, 5 Nazi divisions knifed through blanket-like fog to strike Combat Command B in the pre-dawn darkness of December 19th. For the first time since he launched his attack, von Rundstedt was stopped. A single platoon of tank destroyers, along with bazooka-armed doughboys, came to grips with a column of monstrous Tiger tanks and turned them back after a furious engagement. The 796th Anti-Aircraft Battalion lowered their guns from the sky to the ground, and their withering fire stopped one German ground attack after another. So devastating were their blasts through the Ardennes forest, they were dubbed the Woodchoppers. Finally, help arrived. Rugged paratroopers from the 101st Airborne Infantry moved into positions during the second day of battle. Because the 101st Airborne was the larger force, the 10th was placed under the command of the Airborne Division. And everything the combined forces did thereafter was attributed in the news to the 101st. In effect, the veil had descended deeper on the 10th Armored. Meanwhile, the Germans, unable to penetrate the rock-like Bastogne defenses, surrounded the town, closed the circle 3 days before Christmas. As a kind of twisted Christmas card, the German commander delivered an ultimatum demanding surrender.
An den amerikanischen Befehlshaber der eingekesselten Stadt Bastogne. Das Kriegsglück hat sich gewendet. Dieses Mal wurden die amerikanischen Streitkräfte in und um Bastogne von starken deutschen Verbänden eingekesselt. Weitere deutsche Einheiten haben den Fluss überquert, haben sich in Bewegung gesetzt und Libramont ist in deutschen Händen. Es gibt nur eine Möglichkeit, die eingekesselten amerikanischen Verbände vor ihrer totalen Vernichtung zu bewahren. Das ist die ehrenhafte Kapitulation der eingekesselten Stadt. Um es bedenken zu können, wird eine Frist von 2 Stunden gewährt, die mit dem Erhalten dieser Nachricht beginnt. Wenn dieses Angebot abgelehnt werden sollte, stehen ein deutsches Artilleriekorps und 6 schwere AA-Bataillone bereit, um die amerikanischen Truppen nach dieser 2-stündigen Frist zu vernichten. Alle ernsthaften Verluste bei der Zivilbevölkerung aufgrund dieses Artilleriefeuers würden nicht mit der wohlbekannten amerikanischen Menschlichkeit entsprechen. Der deutsche Befehlshaber Lieutenant General Heinrich von Ludwitz, 47. Panzerkorps.
In far less than 2 hours, the German commander had a one-word answer from General McAuliffe. Nuts. Somewhat confused, the German asked for a translation. It meant, go to hell. The rest of the story is told elsewhere. Just when the besieged garrison was virtually out of ammunition, was rationing food, was desperate for air support, the fortune of war, in the words of the German commander, turned again. On December 23rd, the skies finally cleared. American fighters and bombers caught the Nazis in the fields and woods. Planes dropped ammo and food. And the day after Christmas, Patton's 4th Armored Division broke through from the south. The Tigers had seen the fanatical enemy press in from all sides and rocked beneath terrific artillery barrages and repeated bombings, had frozen in ice-filled foxholes and long snow-covered slopes. Threatened with extinction, the men of the 10th stood, fought, died. The remainder of the epic, like the beginning, was a tale of the individual soldier's raw courage. And now, at long last, the veil has been lifted. They've been saluted by both Combat Command B's Colonel William Roberts and 101st Airborne General Anthony McAuliffe.
In thinking it over, I've decided that if we had been in Bastogne alone without any infantry, we couldn't have held 10 minutes. The 101st Airborne, without the steel that my outfit afforded, could not have held. But the steel of my outfit and the blood and flesh of that their outfit made a pretty tough combination.
It's always seemed regrettable to me that Combat Command B of the 10th Armored Division didn't get the credit it deserved in the Battle of Bastogne. All of the newspaper and radio talk was about the paratroopers. Actually, the 10th Armored Division was in there a day before we were and had some very hard fighting before we ever got into it. And I sincerely believe that we would never have been able to get into Bastogne if it had not been for the defensive fighting of the 3 elements of the 10th Armored Division who were first into Bastogne and protected the town from invasion by the Germans.
A final definitive word from George Koskimaki of the 101st, and author of a book titled Battered Bastards of Bastogne. He wrote, had it not been for the actions of CCB of the 10th Armored Division, there might not have been a Bastogne to defend.